Rockinitis. Hi, cats and kittens. Welcome to Rockinitis. My name is Michael Willmore. And one of my favorite restaurants in town is the only seafood restaurant at Carroll and Hastings. And I went in there the other day and the proprietor there said, I saw you on TV. You were talking about old music. Why do you like old music? And I said, because it's better. Anyway, we both laughed because it's true. Anyway, my co-pilot here is Rob Frith from Neptune Records on Main Street between 19th and 20th.
That's right.
And we're going to be doing an artist who has a falsetto voice.
Hey, so where do you park when you go to the Only?
I usually park somewhere around Carroll and Hastings. Parking
really?
Isn't bad.
Yeah, but if you got anything in your vehicle, it's not going to be there when you get back.
No, I don't have a problem.
Really?
I go in there in the daytime. I don't go there at night.
Oh, man. Well, it's daytime probably, yeah.
Yeah. So I park on the main street, and it's kind of fun watching the junkies in action.
Oh, yeah. It's wild down there now.
Oh, it's really
crazy.
Wild. Anyway, it made number 12 on Billboard on the R&B charts in the summer of 1957 and number 61 on the pop charts. His only hit on the Deluxe record label, but we're not going to play it until you admit that you like men with falsetto voices.
I actually do. What's the guy's name now? Did Lover's Question.
Clyde McFadden.
Clyde McFadden.
Right.
I've always liked Clyde McFadden.
Right.
I think he's got one of the greatest voices. And this really reminds me a lot of Clyde McFadden.
Well, there were guys, you know.
Well, I mean, it's different, but, you know,
yeah.
It has that.
Well, if you think of the 50s, I mean, there was Little Joe Cook and the Thrillers. You know, with Peanuts, ho, 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 ho.
Yeah.
Peanuts.
Yeah.
Which the Four Seasons later covered. And then there's the New Beats with Bread and Butter.
That's right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It really sounds a lot like the
New
Beats.
But he was before the New Beats.
That's right. Oh, yeah. He's from the 50s.
And then there's the Delphonics with, Lala Means I Love You.
Didn't I Blow Your Mind this time?
Yeah. Okay. There you go. Yeah. And then, of course, the Four Seasons and stuff. Okay. The first tune we're going to feature with Donnie Elbert is called What Can I Do? And I got this on a doo-wop tape that a guy sent me from England. And it was in amongst a whole bunch of doo-wop material by vocal groups who specialize in vocal group harmony and the interplay kind of thing. Now, Donnie Elbert is a solo artist, doesn't have a vocal group behind him, but he does his material as if he were a doo-wop group. I mean, you can sort of imagine a doo-wop group in behind him.
Yeah, for sure.
Anyway, he does this song, What Can I Do? And you know how doo-wop is always do-do-do-do, doo-wop doo, and all that. Anyway, he goes, he gets so worked up at one point in the song. He goes, What can I do? Do-do-do. He goes like that, and he turns it into a doo-wop performance.
Right.
Even though it maybe isn't intentional. It really works well. Donnie Elbert with his biggest hit on the Deluxe record label, 1957, What Can I Do?
What can I do to hold your hand? What can I say understand. Oh, what can I do, 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 do? What can I do? What can I do? What
can I do? Oh, I just love the way he plays around with that
great
do-do.
Great vocal control.
Oh, too. Yeah. I mean, the way he plays around with that do-do-do-do,
oh, yeah.
I mean, it's just wonderful stuff. Donnie Elbert, he was on the Deluxe record label for a few years, and probably the item that you have there on the stand-up there is probably the best recorded and best example, if you wanted a single CD.
Oh, yeah.
Of
oh,
his sound.
It's a great collection.
Yeah, that's a nice collection. It's his earliest stuff. And he actually had an album out that was on the Deluxe record label on vinyl back in 1957. And I've never seen it.
No, I've never seen it.
But I saw it listed somewhere, and they wanted like $2,000 or something.
Well, and the thing is with him is he recorded for so many labels and so many singles.
Right.
That it's, I guess that's why there's not that much, because it'd be a lot to get all the permission from all the different labels probably to put
exactly.
out a comprehensive collection.
Yeah. He was a writer, a producer, an arranger, and a multi-instrumentalist.
Yeah, he played a lot of his stuff. He played everything.
On his singles and a lot of his album tracks, he played every instrument on there.
And really
except
well.
Except the strings.
Yeah.
And so they would bring in a string section, and mm-hmm. they would do that, but he did everything else prior to the dubbing on of the strings.
Oh, yeah. He did it all.
So he, you know, anyway, he had 8 singles on the Deluxe record label, which was a subsidiary of the King record label, and the label was based in Cincinnati. Donnie Elbert was born in New Orleans in 1936. His family moved to Buffalo, New York when he was 3, so his New Orleans roots don't go very deep.
No.
Because he left there when he was 3.
That's right.
So Clyde McFadder was a big influence on him.
And we can hear that.
Yes.
For sure.
And but it's funny because when you hear the new beats with Bread and Butter, you immediately think of Donnie Elbert.
Oh, yeah. Well, when I was listening to it before we did the show again, that mm-hmm. came to mind right away.
Yeah.
I was thinking more like that song Pink Dally Roo by...
Right. That really sounds like Donnie Elbert.
It really
and
does.
Yet, Donnie Elbert was years ahead of them.
Oh, yeah.
But they got all the glory.
Because they were in like 65 or
65,
something?
65, yeah. I actually met them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I went
backstage.
Yeah,
they played here.
Yeah. I went backstage and actually met the new Beats. Anyway, he formed a vocal doo-wop group called the Vibra Harps in 1955. The group dissolved in 1957. And Donnie Elbert did the harmony and the guitar. He wasn't a front man.
Yeah, I've never heard that.
At that time. So he cut a demo as a solo singer and gave it to the local distributor for King Records. And they invited him to New York to re-record the tunes. And he was only 21 at the time and cut a lot of things for them. This one here is called Hear My Plea, and the flip side, My Confession of Love. Now, the tune My Confession of Love is actually about heaven and hell. This song here, My Confession of Love, the lyrics go, if I get to heaven and find you're not there, I'll print your name on the heavenly stairs, so all the angels there might see just how much you mean to me. And if you're not there by judgment day, I'll know by then you went the other way.
Wow.
And just to prove my love is true, I'll come down there just to be with you.
Wow.
So what he's doing here is he's saying he's willing to go to hell for her.
Yeah.
Okay, now I've had a couple of women in my life that have told me to go to hell. But I always refused. Anyway, My Confession of Love, a great tune about heaven and hell. We'll hear a tune, which was the flip side of it, called Hear My Plea, Donnie Elbert.
You got me doing the hoochie coochie. It makes me pace the floor. You got me doing the hoochie coochie. It makes me pace the floor. You got me doing things, baby, that I never did before. Somebody somewhere, hey, hey, hear my people. Oh, 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 oh. Somebody somewhere, hey, 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 hear my plea. Do something quick to end this misery.
Really great stuff there by Donnie Elbert, and his contract was up in 1960, so he did various singles for different labels. He recorded on the Red Top record label, and the VJ label, and the J. Lynn label, and the Parkway record label, the Cub label, the Checker label in 1960, 61, 62, 63, before he finally landed at Pittsburgh at a label called Gateway Records in 1964 with a tune called Run Little Girl. Now this made number 130 on the Billboard pop charts, which is not a big hit, I must say.
No, not at all.
Even make the 100 list. Great nonetheless.
All right, there we go.
Wasn't an artist who had big hits, and I recall there was a friend of mine, a guy called Brian Beckett. I know you're not supposed to use real names, but this story doesn't sound truthful to me unless I do use the real name. Anyway, this guy Brian, he had hair. He had really curly hair,
yeah,
and it was always sticking up at all kinds of oddball angles. He was kind of a bedhead.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a portable radio with him, and we were down at this other guy's place. And he says to me, have you heard this record by Donnie Elbert? It's called A Little Piece of Leather. I said, no, I never heard that. Oh, he's fantastic. He's absolutely fantastic. He's so rhythmic. He sings in falsetto. He's this, he's that. I never heard this. So Brian, he had this habit. He used to go over and stand under the light. And he used to say to me all the time, do you see any baldies? What he meant was, do you see any scalp showing through?
Right.
So anyway, we were walking up the lane after leaving this guy's place. And he says, do you see any baldies? I says, well, we're not under the street light. I can't see anything. So we, I'll go over the street light then. And we go over the street light. Just then, he's got this portable radio. Donnie Elbert comes on.
Really?
So it comes on as a little piece of leather. So he has a big fit. Do you see any baldies? I says, no. He says, what do you think of Donnie Elbert? So I says, he's just imitating the new beats. That's what I said.
Isn't that funny?
Anyway, it sticks in my mind. So anyway.
So it was actually played on the radio.
It was actually played on the radio.
Because I don't ever remember hearing it here.
I checked it out. He never actually charted.
Yeah.
But in England, this actually became a fairly big hit.
Yeah.
I think it made like 17 on the British charts.
Well, England, that soul type of stuff was really,
yeah,
really,
he was really big
it's
in the clubs.
Even bigger now.
Yeah, and it was released on the Sue, English Sue record label in 65. But it was never actually charted here. But they did play it as a bubbling under.
Right, yeah.
But it never actually landed on the charts.
Wow.
But anyway, great piece of work nonetheless. Run Little Girl and this other one we're going to play, A Little Piece of Leather. His biggest 1960s hit, Donnie Elbert. I don't know, that should have been top 30.
Oh, yeah.
In my view.
Oh, for sure.
At the time, I thought it sounded too much like the New Beats. But I didn't realize Donnie Elbert was like, you know, 7 years ahead of them.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
You know, like he'd been recording with that falsetto style for years.
When you were talking about doing the show, I was searching for stuff, and I found this one, this Donnie Elbert. It's like a weird import from France, and it's got all these singles on it that don't seem to be on anything else.
So well, I mean,
it must have been on like all these different labels.
Well, we put the show together, yeah. And then you came up with this at the last minute.
Yeah.
I went, where'd you get that?
I know.
I mean, how are we going to fit that in? I've already done the show.
I know. So, anyways, it's just as good, I think. I mean, no, I guess the King stuff's a bit stronger, but I think it's definitely a great CD on its own.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of different versions of some of his stuff.
Yeah.
Some of his stuff is the same. And like it's there's overlapping tracks and whatnot, but it's a good overview.
I think I ordered this on eBay.
Okay.
Yeah, from somebody.
Okay.
And I don't think it was terribly expensive either.
Well, see, by this time he was basically studying what was a hit and what wasn't. Mm-hmm. So he was a big follower of the Tamla Motown sound.
That's right.
So in the last couple of tracks, Run Little Girl and Little Piece of Leather from 64 and 65, you can see that he's studied the Motown sound. He's trying to emulate it.
Well, apparently he did it so well that they wanted to sign him.
Yes, but...
But, yes.
But he was going to an appointment with Berry Gordy Jr.
That's right.
He's going up the front stairs, and Harvey Fuqua of the Moonglows is going down the stairs, runs into him. They knew each other.
He was a big writer-producer
yes.
at Motown.
Harvey, that's right.
Harvey was.
Yes. So anyway, they run into each other, and he goes, you got an appointment with Berry Gordy Jr. this afternoon? And Donnie Elbert says, yeah. And he goes, you know, I'd think twice about signing with Motown, because they want to sign you, and then they want to wait you out. So they want to sign you and sit on you.
That's right.
Because you're a threat.
Yeah, exactly.
Because your sound is so close to the Motown sound, they want to kill you off.
Yeah.
So they're going to sign you up and then not record you.
And plus, he was able to do everything himself.
Yes.
As well. So like.
So he's like a multi-instrumentalist, plays sax, drums,
writes,
piano, writes, produces,
yeah.
sings.
And it's just as good as any Motown record.
And he's just as good as the Motown sound.
Yeah.
So let's sign him up and just sit on him.
Yeah.
You know, not release anything by
just
him.
Like the car companies, when someone comes up with some great thing to
like
save
the
on
Tucker.
Gas, they buy them out. Yeah, they
like
buy
the
them
Tucker
out.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So anyway, basically he heard this foreboding, forewarning,
yeah.
and ran off.
Yeah,
and didn't
right.
sign with Motown. So he continued his Tamla Motown approach with several things that he did. One of the interesting things he did is this English CD I have, which is stuff that he has tracks on it, like the stuff that he did on the Gateway record label, 1965. This is called Down Home Blues. It's an instrumental. And the weird thing is that it's exactly the same tune as Albatross by Fleetwood Mac.
Really?
It's exactly the same tune. If you listen to them, if you concentrate on the guitar, especially, Peter Green took the guitar figure, exactly the
Whoa.
Same guitar
I
figure.
I listened to Albatross yesterday.
Okay.
So it's fresh in my mind.
Anyway, you'll notice it's the same tune exactly. Donnie Elbert playing guitar, sax, drums, everything on the record from an English CD, and it's called Down Home Blues, released originally on the Gateway label, 1965. Donnie Elbert. Okay, that's a real classic by Fleetwood Mac.
So was that like 68 or 69 when that came out?
Yeah, and this is one of the two places I've got that tune.
Because Donnie Elbert moved to England in 66.
Okay.
So I'm just wondering if
Green obviously heard Down Home Blues by Donnie Elbert, reworked it slightly, and called it Albatross.
Yeah, well, it would make sense because he went over there before that. And the guy that owned Blue Horizon Records,
Mike Vernon,
mm-hmm. you know, was into it, so he, you know, it was a good chance that he may have picked up on it.
Anyway, there's a great photo of Fleetwood Mac from the old days on the English Rose LP cover on the back. I saw Fleetwood Mac 3 times. Mm-hmm. I saw different versions of them, the Peter Green Fleetwood Mac, the what's the latter day version of them?
Well, there's the
The Danny Kerwin, Jeremy Spencer version,
and then there's the Bob Welsh version.
I never saw that version. But what was the last version with Stevie Nicks?
With Stevie Nicks, Buckingham, Lindsey Buckingham.
Lindsey Buckingham. Anyway, fabulous group. They were great each time I saw them.
Yeah, they've always been great. And Mick Fleetwood, the constant, you know.
Oh yeah, the constant all throughout. Anyway, great stuff. And Fleetwood Mac's version came out in 68, 69. And
there's a beautiful picture of Mick Fleetwood on the cover here.
Now this is a
in drag.
This is the variant on the Mr. Wonderful album.
Yeah.
And Mr. Wonderful, he looks kind of a little kinky, but here he looks really kinky.
He's kind of naked on the Mr. Wonderful one, isn't he?
Yes.
Yeah, but
he's holding
the record.
He's got leaves in front of him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Stuff like that. Anyway, Donnie Elbert, he basically went sort of disco in later years.
A lot of R&B acts did, though.
Yes. Yeah. And that was fine. You know, and he had his biggest hit of his entire career, which was a cover of the Supremes, Where Did Our Love Go?
This album here.
Yes. And this made number six.
He did a great version of it.
Yes.
Really good.
This made number six R&B, number 15 pop, and it was even a bigger hit in England. It was actually recorded in England, and it came out on the All Platinum record label. I've got it here, too. So I'll fish it out here and put it on. This, when I worked at the Air Affair as a disc jockey.
You know, that club with the airplane and the...
They had an airplane suspended above the dance floor, and this was a tune that I used to have to play as a part of my work ethic because it was a much requested song in the mid-1970s. Donnie Elbert with Where Did Our Love Go? A cover of the old Supremes hit. Eventually moved out to Canada, and got a job with Polygram Records,
that's right, an A&R guy.
Yeah, and so his latter part of his career, he kind of, you know, was like a old horse turned out to pasture.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
And he eventually lived and worked and whatnot in Canada.
Did you find out what city he lived in?
I heard Vancouver.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, he worked for Polygram Records in the mid-1980s. Eventually, he died of a heart attack in 1989, and he was buried in his hometown.
He was only in his 50s, too.
Yes, 52 years old. He was buried in his hometown in Buffalo, age 52 years old. Anyway, great fun stuff from the 1960s and 70s. Donnie Elbert.
Rockinitis.
Oh, doctor.
doctor to tell me what to do. He said, don't stop rocking, son, till you are through. He said, doctor, doctor, what's the matter with me? He said, the Rockinitis won't let you be. Well, I tried to stop rocking, but I've been told